So, good morning, everybody. Am I audible to all of you?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, this is the third lecture on MOS modeling course. In previous two lectures, I discussed about the background of this course. Discuss about the basic MOS capacitor structure and the MOS transistor structure. And in very brief, the evolution of the MOSFET structures, starting from planar MOSFET to gate all around MOSFETs. Okay, everything we have already discussed. Now, in this class, I am going to review some basic concept of semiconductors. Basically, I will be taking three classes to review the semiconductor, basic semiconductor property, and we'll discuss how the carrier concentrations, carriers can be determined, carrier concentration can be determined in the semiconductor. Then we'll talk about the carrier transport. We'll discuss the carrier transport, we'll discuss about the different contacts in the semiconductor. We'll talk about metal semiconductor contact, and we'll also discuss about the p-n junction contact. Okay, so these things I will cover in the introduction part of this course. Okay, and once we'll finish this basic discussion, then we'll switch to the detailed analysis of the MOS capacitor. Okay, and subsequently we'll talk about the MOS transistor, MOSFETs, and other MOSFETs, and the modeling aspects of the metal oxide semiconductor field effect transistor devices. Okay, here I'd like to tell you that the review that I'm going to present is a highly simplified review. Okay. Considering that people are from the different backgrounds, and therefore I will not enter much into the physics. Okay, to understand the steps properly, and also to derive some of the equations that we'll discuss here, you need to have the concept of quantum mechanics and also the thermodynamics. Okay, but the scope of this course, I will just cover the very simplified review of the basic concepts of the semiconductors. Okay, because we are will be utilizing this later on, so this is not the theme of the course. The course is actually on the MOS transistor modeling and MOS capacitor and MOS transistor modeling. So we need some basic concepts. So we'll not derive those concepts. We will not derive those concepts from the first principle, but we will take those concepts as if those concepts already exist, those equations already exist, and we'll simply use those equations. So why I'm going to review here is just to, because students read a different book. Okay, so different notations and different way of expressing the equations are there. So here to give all of you a common platform for our further analysis, I'm just going to review the basic concepts. I will introduce the notations that we will be using throughout this course. Okay, background, let me very quickly summarize some of the properties of the semiconductor device. The semiconductor, you already know, is have conductivity between that of metal and insulator. Its conductivity is greater than that of insulator, but it is less conductive than a metal. But with controlled impurity introduction, we can actually greatly modulate the conductivity of the semiconductor, and that's what basic material very promising for semiconductor device fabrication viewpoint, semiconductor device viewpoint. Okay, so here you can see that I'm going to talk about some topics. So we'll be actually talking about most of the time that the material is under equilibrium, in thermal equilibrium, or it's not an equilibrium case. So equilibrium essentially means that the system is not exchanging energy with from the outside world. Okay, if it's a semiconductor crystal, so definitely we mean that the crystal is not exchanging energy with the outside world. So there is no illumination. There is no illumination on the crystal. Okay. So there is no illumination, no radiation from the crystal, no energy. So no energy transfer from the outside world. Absence of the electric field. The crystal is not subject to the electric field. Crystal or our devices is not subject to the magnetic field. And of course, there is a no temperature gradient in the device. Okay, so temperature is constant throughout the device. Conditions, if these conditions are satisfied, we can assume that the crystal is our semiconductor device is in equilibrium. Okay, and apart from this, you should know that there should not be any the driving force, no externally applied electric field. Okay, local electric field can be present inside the device and system, or the crystal can still be in the thermal equilibrium, but no driving force, no externally applied electric field to drive the carriers. Okay, so this is all these conditions try to consider a crystal in a thermal equilibrium or in equilibrium. Okay, most of the time we will consider that the crystal is in equilibrium until or unless stated otherwise. Okay, for our further discussion. Okay, in the pure semiconductor, basically in this course we'll be talking about the silicon based devices. So semiconductor essentially means that we are talking about the silicon here in this course. Okay, you can see that silicon can be an intrinsic silicon or it can be an extrinsic silicon. Okay, so intrinsic silicon is essentially a pure silicon here, and you know that the silicon silicon lattice adopts the diamond structure where the two interpenetrating FCC lattices forms a single primitive cell of the silicon. And you'll see that each silicon atom will be connected with four neighboring atoms, and the separation between two atoms is around 5 angstrom. Atomic density of silicon turns out to be around 5 into 10 to the power 20 atoms per centimeter cube. Means this is the atomic density. Means if you try to introduce some impurity, of course you cannot introduce impurity greater than this. Okay, into 10 to the power 20 means around 5 into 10 to the power 20 atoms are there in per unit per centimeter cube volume. Okay, but it doesn't mean that all these items all these atoms will be ionized and provide the electrons at the room temperature. You see that at room temperature, what will happen that at 0 degree Kelvin, all the electrons are basically they will be the valence electron. They will not be they cannot they will not be free. Okay, but at room temperature, because of the lattice vibration, at some particular positions in the crystal, the energy will be very high, and because of those energy, some covalent bonds will be broken, and as a result, free electron pairs will be generated in the crystal. So the free electrons. The electron and hole pairs that are generated in the crystal, they are responsible for the current flow in the lattice. If a suitable externally driving force is applied to that particular crystal, so the current flow in a semiconductor in silicon can be either through the motion of the free electron, okay, it can be through the motion of the free electrons, through the motion of the valence electrons, okay. The valence electrons actually move in the crystal from bonds to bonds, okay. See that in a crystal, as you know, that each silicon atom is connected with four neighboring atoms, and these atoms are actually connected, they are held together by the covalent bonds, and the covalent bonds are actually created using the electrons. So at the room temperature, each covalent bond has two electrons. At the room temperature, some bonds will be broken and the electron hole pair will be generated in the crystal. So electron basically are free electron. They have energy, high energy. They can move in the crystal, and so once a parent atom leaves one electron, frequency of the electron in that parent atom. And because that vacancy is basically in that vacancy, some electrons from the neighboring atom come and sit, and therefore you can see that also there is a movement of the valence electron through the bonds, and this can also give rise to this can also contribute to the total current, and this basically the movement of the valence electrons from bonds to bonds are actually identified as a hole movement, and we call that the hole is basically a positive charge with the net charge of 1.6 into 10 to the power minus 19 coulomb. The electron charge is negative, and its magnitude of the electronic charge is again 1.602 into 10 to the power minus 19 coulomb. So the same concept that we have discussed about the electron and holes can also be understood with the help of energy, with the help of energy bands. Okay. So here you can see that the energy bands are plotted. So at x-axis, this is representing the position, and this is representing the electronic energy. So when we consider the electronic energy, then electronic energy is increasing when we are moving upward. And when we think in terms of hole energy, then basically that will be increasing when we downward. So the electronic energy moves upward, it's plotted versus electron, and along this position. And what we have here, you can see the level EV, the valence level, okay, valence energy level. And there are many states below this EV. and all those states are occupied at room temperature. All these states are occupied at room temperature. These states are occupied by just 1 minute. Okay. So we are talking about the energy bands, and basically I told you that the electronic energy is increasing in upward direction, and this is along the position. EV is valence in the highest energy level in the valence band. EC is the lowest energy level in the conduction band. I am not discussing the origin of the bands. We have to study the band theory to understand the origin of the bands. Okay, but here that at 0 degree, there are many allowed states, energy states in valence band as well as in the conduction band. Okay, so all the states of the valence band are occupied at 0 degree Kelvin, whereas all the states of the conduction band are not occupied by the carriers at 0 degree Kelvin. Okay, so and this difference between EC and EV, the lowest energy level of the conduction band to the highest energy level of the valence band, so this is called the band gap EG. Typical value for this EG for silicon is around 1.12 electron volt. Okay, so at room temperature you will see that because of phonon vibration, there will be at some particular position the phonon will have significant energy, and because of the that energy, some of the electrons from the valence band will be able to enter into the conduction band. Although this is this transition will be very very small, very less number of electrons will actually enter into the conduction band compared to the total number of atoms per unit volume. Okay, so when at room temperature some of the carriers enter into the conduction band, and they have the they may have even energy greater than EC. Here I'd like to tell you that the EC is the basically potential energy of the carriers. Okay, so if the carriers is having energy just equal to EC, it will be like in frozen state, it cannot move. So if a carrier is having energy greater than EC, then only it will have a kinetic energy, and the carrier can move in the conduction band once in a directed manner if a suitable external electric field is applied. Okay, is basically the potential energy, and if a carrier that is coming out from the valence band into the conduction band has an energy greater than EC, then it will have a finite kinetic energy, and it can move in the conduction band. Since in conduction band there are many allowed energy states, so the carriers can very easily move in the conduction band. They can occupy the different states, okay, and they can very freely move in the conduction band. That's why we call them free carriers. Okay, whereas the electrons that have left the valence band has created a vacancy in the valence band, and that vacancy can be occupied by a valence electron of the neighboring atom. There could be a movement of the valence electron in the valence band. Okay, but this movement is not as free as compared to the movement of the conduction free electron in the conduction band. And for this reason, we say that the hole, you can say, has the less carrier, less mobility compared to the electronic mobility, because here the movement is restricted. It's bond, and this is in this conduction band, the carrier movement is free. So of course, the electronic mobility. However, this can be even explained with the help of EK diagram, and from the first principle, you can draw the energy band diagram, and from the energy band diagram, you can extract different parameters like effective mass, mobility. You can EK diagram, but I'm not going into that. I'm just simply reviewing some basic property of the semiconductor. So at 300 Kelvin, the band gap is 1.2 electron volt. This is basically, this difference is band gap EG, which is 1.12 electron volt, and this is basically temperature dependent parameter. So with varying temperature, this EG can also vary. Okay, and at room temperature, you see that I here is equal to ni. Ni is basically the number of free electrons in the conduction band, and pi is the hole density in the valence band. You can say electronic density, pi is the hole density. So since you see that when one electron leaves this valence band to the conduction band, it leaves a vacancy behind. So when one electron is moving from valence band to conduction band, it is going to give rise one electron hole pair, one electron in conduction band and one hole in the valence band. Okay, so that's why, since there is no impurity, so number of electron in the conduction band must be equal to the number of hole in the valence band, and that's why the electronic density equal to ni is equal to pi. And at 300 Kelvin, the ni pi is equal to electronic density or hole density is equal to 10 to the power 10 per centimeter cube. If you compare this number with the atomic density of the silicon, as I earlier discussed, that the atomic density of the silicon is very high compared to this. Okay, the atomic density is atomic density for the silicon is 5 into per centimeter cube volume. There are 5 into 10 to the power 22 silicon atoms. Out of 10 to the power 10 are ionized, you can say. So divided, if this is divided by this, you can see that out of only 5 into 10 to the power silicon atoms, one electron hole pair is actually generated. An important number, and you should keep in your mind because this will be used frequently for the calculation here, and this term NIPI will appear very frequently in the different equations. So you must understand, you must keep this fact in your mind. This is the electronic and hole concentration at room temperature in a silicon crystal when the crystal is in thermal equilibrium. Okay, this is the intrinsic silicon. Now let us talk about the extrinsic silicon. The extrinsic silicon is one where some sort of impurities are introduced. Okay, so in silicon, basically we introduce either donor kind of impurity or acceptor kind of impurity. So donor impurities are phosphorus, arsenic, antimony, whereas acceptor impurities are boron. One popular acceptor impurity is boron. Okay, so as you know that phosphorus, arsenic and antimony, these atoms have 5 electrons in their outermost orbits. Okay, and when the donors are introduced in the silicon. Okay, the donors will be active only when a donor atom will replace the parent silicon atom. So when one donor atom is replaced with a parent silicon atom, then has four electrons in the outermost orbit. Okay, so if let's say I'm just drawing the two dimensional picture of silicon lattice. So silicon is connected with four neighboring silicon atoms from all three four sides. Okay, and the covalent bonds are there. Okay, covalent bonds are actually here with sharing electrons. Okay, so you can see that each silicon atom has four electrons in the outermost orbit, and it shares each electron with one neighboring atom. So there are basically you can see that now the silicon has after sharing, it has eight electrons in the outermost orbit, and it becomes stable. Okay, but one when a silicon atom is replaced by a impurity, let's say that it's a pentavalent impurity, phosphorus, silicon is kicked out by one phosphorus atom after it may be a diffusion process or it may be ion implantation process. Okay, but when is placed by the impurity atom, then only this impurity atom is going to be electronically active. Okay, so since the pentavalent impurity has five electrons in the outermost orbit, so four electrons will be interacting with four neighboring atoms, and so the atoms become stable. But the fifth one is very loosely connected with the impurity atom. Now this has become phosphorus. Okay, and its four atoms are actually its four electrons are basically interacting with these four neighboring silicon atoms, but this fifth one is very loosely connected with this phosphorus. Okay, and when even at a very small temperature, a phosphorus atom gets ionized, and this can release this electron, and this electron becomes free. So for that reason, you can see that here below the EC level, the conduction energy level, just below this, there is a donor energy level, ED. Okay, so this donor energy level is basically representing the fifth, you can see here, is representing the donor atom donors here, and this gap is actually very small compared to that of this band gap EG. Okay, so small energy is required to ionize the impurity atom once, and you see that at room temperature we can have the full ionization. So all the loosely bound first electrons here can set free from the parent atom, and they can enter into the conduction band. So as a result, you can see that in this case, the electronic concentration is going to be higher than that of the hole concentration, because you just look at this expression. Now, the total electronic concentration is equal to Nd plus n. The n is the number of electron thermally generated, as it was discussed in the context of intrinsic silicon. So in intrinsic silicon, there will be Ni plus Pi. So let us call it Ni here. Ni, and this is Pi. Okay, so Ni electron in n-type semiconductor, but since these impurity atoms have also introduced the additional electrons, and the number of electron, since we are considering that since this ionization energy of these impurity atoms are very small, this energy gap is very small, so we are considering that at room temperature all the electrons the electrons set free, and therefore the additional electron that will generate in the crystal will be equal to Nd plus is nothing but it is equal to the doping density. Doping density means Nd number of electron, Nd number of impurities are introduced in the silicon lattice, you can say. So Nd is again impurity atoms, impurity per centimeter cube. Okay, let's say that the silicon crystal density is 5 into 10 to the power 20 atoms per centimeter cube, and impurity atoms that are being introduced are basically, let's say, 10 to the power 17 impurity atoms per centimeter cube. So 10 to the power 17, if they get ionized, then they will release 10 to the power 17 number of electrons. Now the total electron is n naught is equal to nd plus n, the number of electron because of the thermal generation, and nd plus is the electron coming out this impurity atom. So n naught nd plus plus ni, and since the nd plus the impurity in practical concentration is going to be much higher than that of the intrinsic silicon concentration, so we can drop this term compared to this term, and we can say that the number of electron n naught is equal to nd, and similarly the whole concentration p naught is equal to pi, which is basically equal to thermal generated carrier because there is no addition here in the whole concentration. So if the impurity, if is p type, if the impurity is a donor impurity, it is going to give rise large number of electrons, and because of the electronic concentration is significantly greater, the material you can say has become n type. Okay, so we call it n-type semiconductor. N-type semiconductors, there are plenty of electrons, large number of electrons, they will act as a carrier of electricity, but the whole concentration is also there, but the whole concentration is much, much smaller than compared to the electronic concentration. And to compute, the electronic concentration is determined. Concentration, as we discussed, is equal to nd. So the electronic concentration can be simplified to n equal to nd. Since this relation holds true, n naught into p naught equal to ni square, even for the doped semiconductor. So since n is known here, n is equal to nd, n naught, better write it n naught here, consistent. So if you substitute n naught here, we can compute the whole concentration in the semiconductor p naught. So p naught is basically equal to ni square upon nd. Okay. And similarly, the similar argument can also be made for another kind of impurity, for trivalent impurity. There could be acceptor type impurity. The boron is the most popular acceptor type impurity. So when acceptor type impurities are introduced, the whole concentration will increase. And if the impurity concentration is Na per centimeter cube, then the whole concentration is going equal to Na plus Pi, but this Na is much greater than Pi, so this can be removed, and the whole concentration in p-type semiconductor can be approximated as Na. Okay, and of course, if p naught is considered, from there we can also compute the electronic concentration n naught, because into ni square holds true here. So if you substitute p naught equal to na in n-type semiconductor material, then we can find out the electronic concentration N naught. So N naught is equal to Ni square upon Na. Okay. So these equations are accurate, but if temperature is extremely low or extremely high, then these approximated equation may not provide concentration of electron and holes. Okay, so now here we are going to talk about the equilibrium in absence of electric field. Let's say that we have a semiconductor which could be either a n-type or p-type, and there is equilibrium, so no exchange of energy from the outside world. Okay, temperature gradient constant, no magnetic field, no driving force from the outside. Okay, for every action there is a reaction in the crystal, and thus equilibrium is established. So under that condition, the electron and hole distributions, E and S distributions, are governed by that statics. Okay, so electron and hole are basically electron and hole distribution are governed by the Fermi Dirac statics, and Fermi Dirac is that Fe, the probability that an energy level E is occupied by an electron is equal to 1 upon 1 plus exponential E minus EF by kT. Okay, so the probability that a state with energy is occupied by electron is given by this relation. This relation is basically called the Fermi Dirac relation. 1 plus exponential E, EF is basically, you can call it the Fermi energy divided by kT. K is Boltzmann constant, T is the absolute temperature. Okay, so this equation reduces to Maxwell-Boltzmann equation. Is not a degenerate one. Okay, so if the doping concentration is not very high, and if you can see that if the Fermi energy level, okay, just let me draw here the band diagram for p-type semiconductor and n-type semiconductor. So I'm drawing here for n-type semiconductor, this is EC level, level, and in between at the middle, close to the middle, it is the intrinsic level EI. So if it is n-type material, then the Fermi level EF is above this EI level, and for a p-type material, of course, the Fermi level EI will be below this intrinsic energy intrinsic Fermi level. Okay, so basically this Fermi level EF, this EF is this Fermi level, and you can define it, the Fermi level can be very easily defined with the help of this equation, that at 0 degree Kelvin, the all energy level found below, all states that are below the Fermi energy level, they will be occupied because the probability of occupancy now becomes 1. Okay. However, if the temperature is not 0 Kelvin, then you see that the probability of occupancy becomes half. Okay. So, thus the Fermi energy level EF can be determined. I must tell you that this EF is going to be very, very have a crucial Fermi energy level, and later on we will define the Fermi potential. This will have a very crucial role in the modeling of the MOS transistor, and even the MOS capacitor you will see later on. So you need to properly follow how potential is defined. You see that there are a number of there are variety of way in different textbooks. The Fermi potentials are different in a different manner. So here you will have to be very, very carefully how this, and you will see that later on whenever we'll use this, we'll write any expression that must be consistent with this definition of the Fermi potential that we are going to see here. So what I wanted to tell you here, that electron and hole distribution is actually governed by the Fermi Dirac distribution function. And if the material is not a degenerate one, so degenerate means if you keep increasing the doping of n-type or p-type, then the energy levels, the Fermi levels keeps moving. Okay, if it's n-type, then it's keep, and you are increasing the donor type of EF moves upward. Okay, so of course, for a certain doping level, this EF comes very, very close to EC. So once the EF goes to either close to EC or EB, we call the semiconductor to be degenerate. So if the semiconductor is not degenerate, not a degenerate one, then we can approximate the Fermi Dirac distribution by Boltzmann distribution, and then with the help of Boltzmann statics, Boltzmann statics, we can find out the hole and electronic concentration. So you must have seen these equations in your UG textbook. The hole concentration in p-type semiconductor can also be represented in terms of the different energy level. In the previous analysis, it was represented in terms of Na and Nd, but here you can see that the hole and electronic concentration can be represented in terms of Fermi energy levels. So hole concentration P naught in a semiconductor is equal to Ni. Ni the intrinsic concentration, Ni equal to Pi. Okay, at in electron and hole concentration in the intrinsic silicon. So the P naught can be written in terms of Ni exponential Ei minus Ef by kT. So this gap, Ef gap here, you can see that this is Ei minus Ef gap. This is this tells us what is if a wider gap between Ei and Ef tells us that the electronic density or hole density is much larger or significant. You see, larger the gap here will indicate that the larger electronic density in the n-type semiconductor material, and here larger gap between EF and EI will tell us that hole concentration is significant. Just look at this expression. This is defined here as EI minus EF. Okay, EI minus EF. So we are taking EF as a reference here, EF as a reference, and we are just defining EI minus EF divided by kT. And for defining the electronic concentration here, we are taking EF minus EI. Okay, unlike this case, here we have taken EI minus EF, but in this case, we have taken EF minus EI. Okay, of course, these are derived from these are not empirical expression. These are basically derived using the concept of quantum mechanics. Okay, but here I am just using taking these expression. I'm not going to derive it. Just you have to careful about the positioning of the EI and EF term. So you can see that if the semiconductor is a n-type semiconductor, then the EF is above EI. EF is EF Fermi energy level is greater above EI level, intrinsic level. And in that case, this EI minus EF becomes negative, and therefore this exponential term will be less than one, you can say. And as a result, this P naught is very, very small. Okay, even smaller than this, you can say Ni. Okay, because this will be a fraction of one. And when for the same case, for the n-type case, since EF is greater than EI, so this EF minus EI is a positive term, and exponential positive means a large quantity, and therefore this Ni is multiplied by a large factor, and therefore the electronic concentration will be much higher. Okay, so much higher than Ni. So electronic concentration will be much greater than 10 to the power 10 electrons per centimeter cube in an n-type semiconductor material, where it will be smaller than that in a p-type semiconductor material. Okay, vice versa for a p-type. If you consider a case of p-type semiconductor material, then this Ei minus Ef become positive. In a p-type semiconductor, you see that Ef. Okay. Type. So in a p-type semiconductor, you can see that Ei is above Ef. So this Ei minus Ef is positive, and therefore this is a large quantity, and this large quantity is multiplied by this Ni. So P naught will be, of course, greater than Ni. So P naught will be greater than 10 to the power 10 carriers per unit volume for the p-type case, whereas the electronic concentration, now since we are dealing with p-type material, so Ei is greater than Ef, so Ef minus Ei becomes negative, and now this N naught will be much smaller than Ni. N naught is much less than you can say 10 to about 10 per centimeter cube. Okay, quality, you know, is Boltzmann constant, but here you will see that having these two terms, Ei minus Ef, is going to complicate the further analysis. So rather than using Ei and Ef in this equation, we can use make use of the Fermi potential. So first we will see how the Fermi potential is defined, and then we'll look at the modified equations. Okay. We are going to define the Fermi potential phi f. This is of course potential Ei and Ef, where energy levels. Phi f is a potential. So phi f is defined as Ei minus Ef by Q. So for a p-type, in a reference to a p-type semiconductor, Ei is much greater than Ef. Okay, so this phi f is going to be positive, because in a p-type material, if this EC level, EV level, and this is your Ei level close to the balance energy level, so since we are defining Ei, since we are considering Ef as a Fermi level as a reference, okay, so here Ei minus Ef is a positive, because Ei energy level is higher than Ef energy level as far as the electronic energy is concerned. So Ei minus Ef divided by Q is higher. Okay, this is the so-called Fermi potential. Okay, in many textbooks, the phi f is taken as an absolute potential too, but here we are going to define the Fermi potential with respect to the Fermi level, in with respect to the intrinsic you can say Fermi level of the semiconductor, and that's why we see this term Ei minus Ef, because here the Fermi potential, the potential is defined by taking, you can say, Ef as a reference, and then we see how Ei is, how much Ei is deviated from Ef. Okay, so phi f is Ei minus Ef by Q, and if we can define this, but then we can use we can rewrite that these two equations. We can rewrite these two equations in terms of Fermi potential. Previously, these are defined in terms of intrinsic energy level and Fermi energy level. Now, these can be defined in terms of Fermi potential here. And now you can see that the Fermi potential here, phi f, is to define the whole concentration P naught. P naught is Ni into e to the power phi f upon phi t. phi t is now kt by q. Phi t is basically kt by q. K is Boltzmann constant, T is absolute temperature, Q is the electronic charge. Okay, so the temperature equivalent potential you can say, and basically this is the energy level required to change the entropy by one unit. Okay, but here we simply call it the thermal equivalent potential, that is phi t, which is equal to kt by q. Okay, so p naught is n phi f by kt. If you look at the above expression, there was a term, the two above equation, it was EI minus EF by KT. Okay, so these were in terms of energy. So we have to both multiply and divide by a term Q. So EI minus EF by Q becomes a potential. EI minus EF by Q becomes phi F. And Q by KT becomes 1 by. So you will see that in numerator, we get the two potentials here in numerator and denominator. Okay, so here we get two potentials in numerator and denominator. Phi f is Fermi potential and phi t is the temperature equivalent potential, phi t. Okay, now these two are potentials and Q included in phi f and phi t. Therefore, Ni e to the power phi f upon phi t is the whole concentration, and the electronic concentration of course will come with minus sign because phi f is defined as Ei minus Ef by Q, and here we see Ef minus Ei by Q. So this N naught, the electronic concentration, now comes with minus phi f term. Okay, N not equal to Ni e to the phi t. Okay, so with two equations we can also define the Fermi potential using these two equations. That is done here. So phi f can be now written as phi t natural log of p naught upon Ni, because p naught was what? P naught was Ni e to the power phi f upon phi t. So by rearranging the terms, we can get the Fermi potential in this fashion: phi t natural log of p naught upon Ni, and we have another expression for the that equation. We can get the following expression for phi f. Okay, n equal to Ni e to the power phi f by phi t, and we had p naught equal to Ni e to the power phi t. Okay, so from this we get this expression, and from this we can get this expression for the Fermi potential. So phi t natural log of p naught upon Ni minus phi t natural log of n naught upon Ni. Now if you are considering that all impurity atoms are ionized, if because we are dealing with the doped semiconductor, and if all atoms are ionized, then p naught is of course equal to p naught will be of course equal to Na, and n naught will be equal to Nd, as we have already discussed. This is equal to Nd, this becomes equal to Na. So the two equations, the two Fermi potentials, can also be represented here as phi t natural log of Na upon Ni, and phi f is here minus phi t natural log of Nd upon Ni. So the Fermi potential for a p type can be expressed like this, and for n type can be also expressed in for p type it can be expressed in terms of Na, And for n type, it can be expressed in terms of, okay. Now, if doping is very high, then above equation may not valid. Consider EF equal to ECN for n type and EB for p type. If it is a p type and you keep increasing the doping, EF goes below. And it can coincide in degenerate case. EF will be very close to EB, and for p-type material, for n-type material, EF will be very close to EC, for degenerate n-type semiconductor material. Okay. For silicon, EF is of course this is for some value of Na. It is computed. Okay. So we can draw here. We can compute the phi F value. Fermi potentials if the Na and values are given. Okay, if Na value is given, we can compute the phi f. We can, and phi f is nothing but it's a measure of how far EI is with respect to EF, respect to EI. Okay, that is basically phi f is actually the quantitative measurement of that. Okay. All right. So before I proceed for equilibrium in presence of electric field, okay, I'd like to tell you about some other important parameter, which is electron affinity. Okay, that we'll be talking about very frequently in coming. Okay, so here we have actually drawn the EC level. Okay, this is especially good for, I mean, very, it will be useful for those who are from electrical engineering background only. So EC, EV, and very close to the mid of this band gap is EI. Then let's say that we are talking about n-type semiconductor material, so Fermi level somewhere here. Okay. So the vacuum level could be somewhere here, okay. And so you'll see that in some reference, the vacuum level is used to measure that different energy, and in some other references, we can use the EI level to measure the different potentials or energy, or we can also use sometimes EF levels to measure different potential discussion. We are going to take EF as a reference. Okay, so that's why you'll see that in your textbook, the arrow like this means this is our actually reference. EF is our reference here. Okay, so here I just wanted to tell you about some electron term. Electron affinity is an important parameter of a semiconductor, and that is nothing but this gap from the vacuum level to the EC level. Vacuum level is basically representing, let's say, the electron which has come out just out of the material. Okay, it's entirely completely free. Not only it's in conduction band, but you can say it has just left the material and close to the surface. Okay, so that in energy of that electron is basically vacuum level electron. So from vacuum level to EC level, we call it the electron affinity. Electron affinity. For silicon, this value is around 4.05 electron volt. Band gap, you already know, is EG. EG is basically EC minus EV, which is around 1.12 electron volt. Okay, so EI, since it comes in the middle of this forbidden gap, so this difference EC and EI, EC minus EI, this is approximately EG by 2. Take silicon case, for intrinsic silicon case, and for extrinsic 2. The extrinsic silicon is in under equilibrium, okay, no electric field. So in that case, this gap EI minus EC or EI minus EV is basically the half of band gap, 1.12 electron volt divided by 1.12 electron volt divided by 2. So it is around 0.56 electron volt. So that's why you saw that here. You see here that for degenerate silicon, phi f is considered to be 0.56 volt. Okay, why? Because for a degenerate, let us say n-type silicon. So for n-type silicon, for degenerate case, and EF both are coinciding. Two are coinciding here. So this gap comes out to be 0.56 electron volt, and this is what, this is basically EF minus EI. Okay, this is EF minus EI. So if you recall, phi F was defined as EI minus EF by, okay, and EI minus EF in this case is of course minus 0.56 electron volt divided by electron, so it is minus 0.56 volt. So for n-type semiconductor material, this EI minus EF is going to be negative because EI is less than EF, and since it is degenerate, then EF is coinciding with EC. So the phi f comes to be minus 0.56 volt. Here, because phi f is this divided by q, energy unit is electron volt. C is basically cancelled by this q. So this is minus 0.56 electron volt. Similarly, for p-type semiconductor, if it is degenerate, then phi f turns out to be 0.56. So here you see that 0.56 positive and minus 0.56 negative. Okay. Work function you can also define similarly. Work function is basically the difference between the EF and the vacuum level, this energy level and this energy level. Okay. So EF can further be expressed in terms of EG and the doping level. So that we'll discuss this later on whenever this will become more appropriate. Okay, whenever some reference will appear, then we'll talk about this. So let us stop here today. We'll continue this in next class. We'll continue reviewing the property of basic semiconductor material. Okay. And if you have any doubt, then you can please ask your questions, okay, based on our discussion of the day. Okay, anybody, any question, please ask. Because it was concept, so I hope that all of you are familiar about these facts, okay. And it was important here because of the one reason that I wanted to give the same platform for all of you. All of you are coming from the different backgrounds, so you might be using the different notations for the different parameters. For example, for Fermi level, for Fermi energy potentials, you might be defining it in a different in a different manner. But in this course, we are going to define this in this, consider this in this particular manner. And this is same for everybody. And for our further discussion, we are going to adopt the same approach. Okay. If any question, please ask, or you can also drop your questions in the chat box. Okay. We'll certainly discuss that in the beginning of the next class. You can not, you should drop in your in our E507 WhatsApp group. Okay. Because this link is temporary. Okay. You cannot drop message here in this chat box once from this platform. Okay, so any question, anybody, please ask, feel free to ask. Is it fine for everybody? Is it okay? Neil Kumar.
Yes, sir, I can hear you, sir.
Okay, so you might have, there may be another class scheduled after this. Okay, so I am just signing out.
Yes, sir.
Please be in touch. Drop your question in WhatsApp group if you have any. Okay, anybody, all of you. Okay, and keep asking questions in between. That will make more sense of our discussion. Okay, this is, I understand that this was very preliminary stuff. So, there was nothing new for all of you, okay. But if you'll involve in the discussion, then it will be more interesting in future, okay. Otherwise, it will become dull. No interest from the very beginning, okay. Because a lot of mathematics is expected, and there are so many dimensions of the modeling. So at least you should be very very comfortable with these initial notations and some basic concept, and that only it will be interesting course. Okay, so thank you for joining me today. We'll definitely meet again for our schedule, and then we have missed two classes, so I will also reschedule those two classes in this week. Okay, so I hope that all of you will find some extra time for the extra class. Thank you. Thank you all. Thank you very much.